gives you the word of God to two prophetic voices in their season. Ezekiel chapter 3 and verse number 17, God speaks to the prophet Ezekiel, and he says, "Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel, for the house of God. And I made you a watchman. Therefore, hear a word from my mouth." Again, not just read and listen. Hear a word from my mouth. I'm going to talk to you. You're a watchman. Therefore, hear a word out of my mouth. Jesus did it. Not just read the scriptures, and you ought to read the scriptures, and God speaks through the scriptures, but what he's saying to the watchman is, I'm going to talk to you from my mouth to your ears. He says, I made you a watchman for the house of Israel, a watchman for the house of God. Therefore, hear a word from my mouth and give them warning from me. Jeremiah chapter 15, 17, I didn't give them to them at the screens, because when I came into the building, the word of the Lord came to me and he said, give them these two passages before you say anything. And so Jeremiah chapter 15, I'm listening all the time. I tell people all the time, preaching is a dialogue, it's not a monologue. You are to be hearing and speaking, not just talking. Jeremiah chapter 15, Jeremiah is speaking, and he says this, he's talking to God. He said, I did not sit in the assembly of the mockers, nor did I rejoice. I sat alone because of your hand. In other words, I didn't go on this side, and I didn't go on this side as a prophet. I had the responsibility to stand alone if necessary, because your hand is on me. Because I've heard from you. In other words, and the prophetic responsibility requires sometimes that you will not be able to gallop with the gallop. The prophetic responsibility requires sometimes that when everyone is going this way and others want to go that way, you have to stay right here and say, I'm not going either way, because God has spoken to me. His hand is on my life, and I have responsibility to speak for him, not for you, or you, or you, or you, or anyone else. And so, Israel. Chapter number 9 and verse number 8. Hear the word of the Lord. You still here? You still want to be here? You still? Ezra chapter 9 and verse number 8. And Ezra is writing under the influence of the Holy Spirit. And he says, and now for a little while, grace has been shown from the Lord our God to leave us a remnant to escape and to give us a peg in his holy place, that our God may enlighten our eyes and give us a measure of revival. Everybody say, and give us a measure of revival. And give us a measure of revival in our bondage. Verse 9, for we were slaves, yet our God did not forsake us in our bondage, but he extended mercy to us in the sight of the kings of Persia to revive us, to repair the house of God. Get what the mercy and the grace was given for. To revive us, to repair, number 2, the house of our God, number 3, to rebuild its ruins, and number 4, and to give us a wall in Judah and in Jerusalem. I want to talk from the subject grace for a little while. Look at your neighbor and say, grace for a little while. Now, this was the word that the Lord gave me some months ago. He said, I'm getting ready to extend to this nation, and more specifically to my church in this nation, grace for a little while to get some things done. And while people are picketing and marching, and while the demons are stirred and angered because God has And you've got to understand, you've got to discern spiritually, not just naturally, that all of that is going on, God is doing something with His church and with His people who can hear Him. And that is why it is essentially important for the prophets to rise. If you were in the prayer for prayer hour, the Sunday before the election, we've got it recorded. As we were praying, there was a prophetic utterance that came out of my mouth, and the Spirit of God said to me, the prophets are coming out of the caves. The prophets are coming out of the caves. It was the Sunday before the election, and the utterance came out of God said, the prophets are coming out of the caves. And in that moment, I knew exactly what He was talking about. Because something has opened up, and what you and I as people of God must do now is we must understand. Let me say a couple of things, and I must speak the word of the Lord. Something supernatural is happening in America. And while people of natural inclination do not discern it, and even preachers and church folks are picketing and yelling and saying ignorant things in the streets, the Spirit of God is up to something supernatural. So let me go ahead and say these things. I thank God. I think Mr. Obama, I believe he is a good and well-meaning man. But as a president, he was either undiscerning of or too beholden to the subtle demonic powers that mask themselves in political garb, in the political garb of inclusion and openness, but in actuality, they wear the robes of intolerance to the Judeo-Christian ethic as they themselves demand tolerance of their doctrinal persuasion. You hear me? And hear me very well. For I think Mr. Obama is an honorable man, and he was certainly a man who gave people of color in this nation a magnificent, iconic picture of a man of color who was a family man, and an ethical man, and an upright man. As a president, he will go down in history as the president who did more in 8 years to undo the Judeo-Christian ethic in this nation and to remove this nation from its foundational principles than any president, certainly in recent history, and perhaps any president ever. And you may not like me for saying so, but I will stand alone if I must, because the hand of God is on me. He has told me to say it. And it is time, especially for people of color, black, brown, or whatever you may be, to stop exalting your ethnicity above your Christianity and start hearing the voice of the Word of the Lord. In the last 8 years, every community in this nation has had their tongue loose to speak freely whatever their doctrine demands and whatever their minds can manifest. But the prophetic community has been threatened to keep silent or risk exclusion from the mainstream of progressive exposure and political discourse. Now, whether you like it or not, the president that has been elected is purposed by God to be an instrument in His hand for this nation. This presidency is ordained to be an instrument in the hands of God for this nation. And before you say, what are you talking about, Bishop? Hear me very clearly. He is ordained to be an instrument in the hand of God, and His presidency is ordained to be an instrument in the hand of God, not exclusively for what President Trump or his administration will do for the body of Christ, which includes the church and the nation of Israel. Let me say something very clearly, because when you hear the words body of Christ, from now on, you've got to stop just thinking church. The body of Christ is not just the church. The body of Christ is the church and the nation of Israel. It is the church and the Jewish people, because the word Christ is the Hebrew word Messiah, which we translate anointed, and the Jews are God's anointed people, just like the church are God's anointed people. And God's idea in this last day is to create one new man, if you read the book of Ephesians. But let me say it very clearly. And let me say it very clearly. Before you pick it, and before you side with this ignorant feminist spirit that is trying to resurrect its head, and you may not like me, but we don't need a feminist move in the body of Christ. Jesus made the equal. He said, in Christ, there is neither male nor female. You don't like me? I don't care. The fact of the matter is, we need to stop debating in the church. If a woman can preach, of course she can. If a woman can teach, of course she can. But it's the ignorance in pulpits that has given way to the prominence in politics. So let me say it very clearly. This presidency, this president, it is in the hand of God, not simply for what his administration will do for the body of Christ, but also for what this president and this administration will not allow to be done to the church and to God's people Israel. Let me say it very clearly. The foot of this government will, for a season, be taken off of the neck of the church and the political chokehold of a progressive liberalism will be for a moment removed from the prophetic voices of America. Now let me say, speak the word of God to you, because God said this to me very clearly. He said, the prophets are coming out of the caves. He said, for Ahab is fallen, and Jezebel for a season has been put down. I'm going to say it again. He said, the prophets are coming out of the caves because Ahab has fallen. And Jezebel for a season has been put down. I'm talking about spirits, not people. See, what you don't understand is when Ahab and Jezebel were in charge of Israel, the prophets had to go into the caves and they had to be fed supernaturally because the spirit of Ahab and the spirit of Jezebel wanted to silence the prophetic voice. So Elijah had to go into a cave. And the moment those two were dead, the prophets began to come out of the caves and Israel had a revival. Are you still in the building? I said, are you still in the building? And so the word of the Lord came to me very clearly. And he said, son, now I want you to say this. But as I speak, then he said, tell my anointing to seize the day, for this window will not be open forever. But revival will be seen in these days. This is the word of the Lord. Now, when I say this president and this presidency is an instrument in the hands of God, let's make sure we understand that no instrument of God is perfect. I am his instrument. I am not perfect. You are his instrument. Legion is saying, you know you ain't perfect. The church is to be God's instrument, and we are not perfect. But what we must understand is that God does not seek golden vessels, and God does not seek silver vessels, but God seeks yielded vessels. God does not equip the called. God does not call the equipped. He equips the called. If he calls you, he'll equip you. He's not looking for people who are equipped before they're called. Here's what people who are looking at this election and don't understand what just happened. Let me explain to you what happened. God is able to use vessels that are beholden to no one. And see, when no one owns you, you can speak to everybody and tell them whatever it is you want to say. And suddenly we have a man in the White House who's not owned by the political class. He's not owned by the media. He's not owned by special interests. He's not owned by the gay and lesbian forces. And we got first force marching. in the scriptures that you and I say we believe. God gave a donkey the gift of speech for a moment in order to rebuke a prophet who was about to go astray and make a great error. Is it not possible, because the church has been so silent, God has given voice to someone who is not beholden to Him, and for the first time in years, we've heard a president stand up and say, God will protect us. Did you not hear that? Now, let someone take me out of context. I am not calling our current president a donkey. I'm giving you a scriptural example that God can use whatever He wants, whenever He wants, to do whatever He wants, and He doesn't have to ask the scriptural, the ecclesiastical, or the political elite. He doesn't have to ask senators, and He doesn't have to ask the best television evangelists. And this is what is upsetting people. God has skipped over people who think they're in control, both in pulpits and in politics. It's quiet in the building. In a critical season, God will use whatever and whoever He chooses. And no one is excluded from divine use. When the hour is late and the candle is about to go out, God will skip over educated, knowledgeable, learned people, and He will start speaking to babes. When the candle was about to go out in Israel, God skipped over Eli and started talking to a little boy named Samuel and began to speak to him. And so it is not unusual and it is not crazy that God would choose a political child in order to begin speaking something that the nation needs to hear. Quiet in the building. Look at your neighbor and say, he ain't nearly done. But I'll abbreviate my words. So let me give you a little context. Ezra is a very interesting story, and I would encourage every one of you to read the entirety of the book of Ezra during this consecration. It's only 10 chapters. You can read a chapter a day for the rest of the consecration, and it would fill at least 5. Ezra led the second of 3 groups returning from the Babylonian captivity to Jerusalem. The entire 10 chapters of the book of Ezra cover a period of about 80 years. Let me give you some context here. Ezra was one of the men who led the post-exile returnees. Israel, the people of God, had gone into Babylonian captivity under Nebuchadnezzar because they refused to worship God and to speak up for God as God directed. And so God allowed them for a season to be taken over by a Babylonian king by the name of Nebuchadnezzar. And because the people never believed that such a thing could happen, the contemporary prophets, when Jeremiah and others were saying that Israel, the nation, is about to be taken over by forces, nobody would believe it because they thought, well, we've had blessing and prosperity all these years, but God was tired of a church that would not speak up for Him, and a people that had an outward form of worship, but in their hearts were compromising and would go with anything they got married to. And so God sent a prophet by the name of Jeremiah, and Jeremiah prophesied for 70 years Israel, or the nation, will go under captivity. In other words, they will be ruled by a spirit that they are not accustomed to. They will be ruled by a spirit that will take them away from the worship of God rather than worshiping God. And whether you realize it or not, for the last several years, probably for the last 20 years, but certainly for the last 8 to 10, there has been a spirit in America that has been hovering, trying to move us away from the Judeo-Christian ethic, trying to stop the voice of prophets, taking prayer out of school, telling Christians, you can't speak up. Everybody else can say whatever they want to say, but if you stand for the Word of God, they call you closed-minded, stupid, ignorant. That spirit has been hovering over this nation. And so what happens when a nation that says they love God won't serve God is God will allow them temporarily to be ruled by the spirits they've chosen. And that's what God allowed in Israel. Let me say it clearly. That's what has been allowed in America. But the bondage that God prophesied through Jeremiah was for 70 years. And God said, after 70 years, I'll return you to this place. And so the Bible declares that Nebuchadnezzar died and other kings of Babylon and Persia began to rise up. And there was a king that rose up who was a descendant of Nebuchadnezzar. Now remember this, Nebuchadnezzar was the Persian king who went into Jerusalem, tore down the temple, destroyed the city, burned it with fire, and took the golden and silver vessels that were to be used in the house of God for ministry. The golden altar, the bronze laver, the Ark of the Covenant, all the vessels and tools, he took them and put them in the house of his God. Are you still here? And so for 60 years, Israel was under the Babylonian captivity. Nebuchadnezzar died, his grandson Belshazzar, and there was a series of kings until a man by the name of Cyrus, a king by the name of Cyrus, came into the kingdom of Babylon. And Cyrus began to be dealt with by the hand of God. And what Cyrus did, as he was being dealt with by the hand of God, God got a hold of Cyrus, and Cyrus issued a decree. Now get it, there were 60 years into a 70-year prophesied captivity. They were supposed to be in bondage for 70 years, but God is merciful. And he cannot stand to see his children who long to serve him in bondage. And so when a group of them began to cry out, and Daniel was one of them, that's what the Daniel fast was all about. While Daniel was in Babylon, he began to seek the Lord to find out, why are we in this condition and when are we getting out? And that's when God sent the angel to Daniel in Daniel chapter 10 and began to give him revelation. So even in the time of bondage and captivity, there were a few good men. There were a few good ones who were standing there and believing and standing on the Word of God. Are you still here? And what eventually happened is God raised up a king by the name of Cyrus and began to get a hold of it. And Cyrus gave a decree that any Israelite who wanted to leave Babylon, nudge your neighbor, squeeze a hand, and tell him, the question is, do you want to leave? That's the question. If you want to stay, then go out there and pick it with them folks. But if you want to leave and see a revival, Cyrus gave a decree that anybody who wanted to leave Babylon could go back to Jerusalem and begin to rebuild the city and begin to rebuild the temple. So what happened was, there was a shift in the political government that allowed the people of God to go back to doing what they were actually supposed to be doing all the time. Cyrus was not an Israelite. He was not a covenant man, meaning he didn't go to church like you and I. He didn't read the Bible like you and I. He didn't live by all the principles that you and I live by. But God got a hold of his heart and turned it toward God's people and said, whatever you do, you leave my people alone. You can rule the government, but you let my people do what they're supposed to do. He that has ears to hear. Let him hear. And so, when Cyrus gave the decree, those of you that have ears to hear and know anything about your biblical history, you'll begin now to put things together. When Cyrus gave the decree, 60 years into the captivity, the first leader that rose up from Babylon and took a group of people back to Jerusalem was a man by the name of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel had the responsibility of rebuilding the temple. And so when Zerubbabel began to rebuild the temple, the work prospered. And if you read the decree of Cyrus, which I will read to you in just a moment, Cyrus said, anybody who wants to go can go. And he said, and by the way, I'm going to give you gold and silver and anything you need to build the temple. In other words, the government funded the restoration. Nobody's saying nothing to me. But funds began to be released for the rebuilding of the house of God. And when I say the house of God, I'm not talking about brick and mortar. I am telling you that substance is being released out of the spiritual atmosphere so that the house of God, the people of God, can begin to occupy their place again in this nation and stand and say what thus saith the Lord without threat and without fear. So the first, please hear me, so the first group to come back was the group under Zerubbabel, and they began to rebuild the temple. Now, why rebuild the temple? Because Israel was a nation who was called to serve God. And if the temple wasn't properly constructed, they couldn't give their sacrifices. They couldn't do the things that God had directed in the law of Moses. So the first order of business was the rebuilding of the temple. The second group came back from Babylon to Israel under the leadership of this man by the name of Ezra. Ezra's responsibility was to restore proper temple worship and to bring a revival of the hearing of and the teaching of the Word of God. The third one who brought back a group from Babylon to Israel was a man by the name of Nehemiah. Nehemiah's job was to rebuild the wall. So get it. When the captivity was over, the first group came, they were to rebuild the temple. The second group that came, the first leader was raised up, Zerubbabel, to reconstruct the temple. The second leader and his team were raised up by the name of Ezra to restore proper temple worship. And the third leader that was raised up to rebuild the wall. The wall represents political and military protection. The rebuilding of the church or the temple represents spiritual restoration. But Ezra's job was to teach and bring the Word of God back to the people. Why? Because it does no good to have a church if the people don't know the Word and don't stand on the Word and don't know how to live by the Word of God. And even if you build a wall and strengthen your military might, if the church is in spiritual compromise, your wall will not be a protection enough. And it is time for somebody to lift up their voice and say, America will not be protected only by its air force. It must be protected by its prayer force. It's got to be protected by a people who are occupying their place. You're still in the building. Well, let me hurry here because I've got just a few minutes. Go to Ezra chapter 7, verse number 6. You still love me? I appreciate that. But you know, in the final analysis, there ain't no change. Nothing I do. Somebody's going to love me someday. Watch this. Ezra is described in the Word. In Ezra chapter 7 and verse 6, Ezra is described as a man who was skilled, who was a skilled scribe in the law of Moses, which the Lord God of Israel had given. Are you still here? In Ezra chapter 7, verse 10, Ezra is described as a man who had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. Get it. Not just to seek the Lord, but to seek the Word of God. He was a man who had decided, I'm going to study the Word until I find out what God means when He says what He says and how we're to do it. He had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord, watch this, and to do it. Everybody say, to seek God and to do what He says. and to teach the statutes and ordinances in Israel. In other words, he was a man who had decided, I am going to study the Word, I am going to understand the Word, and I am going to preach and teach the Word to the people of God, no matter what they want to hear, I'm going to preach the Word to them. Are you still here? The Bible says that Ezra also, in Ezra 7:11, was an expert in the words of the commandments of the Lord. Get it? Not just an expert in the commandments. He was an expert in the words of the commandments. He understood what God meant when he said what he said. He didn't just understand what God said. He understood what God was after when he said what he said. He was expert in the words of the commandments of the Lord and the statutes to Israel. Now watch this. Go quickly to Ezra chapter 9. I'm almost done. Believe it or not, somebody say, thank God. In Ezra chapter number 9, in our text, God says, and now for a little while, Ezra says rather, and now for a little while, grace has been given. Ezra is a part of these post-exilic returnees. And while Nehemiah is responsible for rebuilding the wall, as I said, Ezra was to preside over the restoration of proper temple worship. Nehemiah's restoration, as I said, represents political, defense, national security. But Ezra's represents the spiritual restoration of the nation and the house of God. It's interesting that Ezra doesn't show up in his own book until chapter 7. In other words, everything that Ezra writes about in the first six chapters are things that are happening before he arrives in Jerusalem. He's recounting the history, but in Ezra chapter 7, Ezra himself shows up. Now, what does that mean? It means that Ezra's book is not only a story of what Ezra does, but a story of God's preparation for what Ezra is purposed to do. And let me announce to you that God has prepared for what you and I are being called to do. The gifts, the anointings, the things that God is putting in our spirit, the atmosphere has been prepared. And that's why some of you have been carrying things for a while that have not been able to be released, because the atmosphere was not yet right for what you and I were carrying. But now is your time. Slap your neighbor high five and tell them, now is your time. The atmosphere is right. The spirit of the enemy will no longer be able to abort anointed baby visions. They're going to come out and they're going to manifest, because Ahab is dead and Jezebel has been put down. Are you listening to me? Slap your neighbor high five and tell them what's in you is about to come out. And tell them there will be no adversary that will be able to stop it or kill it or resist it or stand in its way. There are some of you that tried things 4 or 5 years ago, and God is stirring them in you again. Why? Because the atmosphere now is right for your baby to be born and thrive. I am telling you, even the manifestation of this church, the place of grace, is a manifestation of God on time and in time. The atmosphere has been prepared for what you and I are anointed to do, and we are going to flourish in it because it is our time. You must understand this, children. You must understand that the condition of a nation is a direct reflection of the condition of the church. The reason our nation is divided is because the church is divided. We are still divided across ethnic lines. We are still divided across socioeconomic lines. We are still divided across political lines. And what the church is supposed to do is to stand up and say, we are handling from the big place of standing in the gap. We are making up the heads. We are between black and white. We are between Republican and Democrat. We are between rich and poor. We are standing in the gap. We are making up the heads. The prophetic voice is to be the middleman. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation
that means bringing enemies together. But you cannot do it if you side with worldly wisdom and march with political lunatics. You've got to have the Spirit of God and the wisdom of God and the discernment of God. Lay your hand upon your belly and say, God, bring me the wisdom. Give me the wisdom that when I speak, I will not divide, but I will bring together. Give us the wisdom to manifest the things that will bring a nation together. Look at your neighbor and say, we've been given grace for a little while. I know that this is a little jarring to some, but I've got to finish this. And so, let me help you understand what God means when he says, and now, grace for a little while, because it's a very interesting thing, especially for those who have this understanding of grace that has been emphasized in the church. And let me say this very cautiously. While there has been a great emphasis of messages coming through Christian television, that's why you got to watch what you hear on Christian television. And that is not to say the men and the women who speak are not sin of God. But what you have to understand, and is what is very interesting now, the major voices that are speaking to this nation are not from this nation. The major moves of God that are influencing this nation are not from this nation. They're in Asia, they're in Australia, they're not in this nation. And while there is credence to be given to them, and while there is something of God in them, you cannot take words from another nation and think they are your own. Because what God will do is he raises up men and women who are to speak to the environment in which they live. And the problem is those messages are not changing our nation because the prophetic unction is coming from somewhere else. And that unction is not for this nation. Now, I didn't say they're not preaching truth. I didn't say there are things that can be gained. But what I am saying, you got to eat what is for you and spit out what is not, because the origin of it is not based out of the environment in which you are living. And what God always does through his church is he raises up an answer to a nation through the church. So what is coming out of another nation is an answer to that nation, but maybe not to yours. He that has ears to hear, let him hear. Somebody's got to say this, because we are being swayed, and their revival may not mean the revival for you. What they're saying may not cause the situations in your community to change, because God raises up messengers for their environment. Now, you would say, well, God is wise enough that he's going to put you on national television. He's going to give you a word for the globe, but he's also going to give discerning people discernment to know that's not for me. That's for me. What you just said is for me, but that's not for me. That part is not for me. You know, you smile. Are you doing this at all? So watch it. When he says grace here for a little while, it's a very interesting word, and I'm almost done. Because when Nehemiah says that now grace has been given to us for a little while, the Hebrew word here for grace is not the Hebrew word hesed, which is the Hebrew word that is generally translated from Hebrew into English grace. It is the word hesed, which is translated loving kindness. This Hebrew word hesed, by the way, is in the name Bethesda, Beth Hesed, out of which the place of grace comes. Bethesda, house of loving kindness, grace, mercy. Are you listening to me? But the Hebrew word that is generally translated grace, which means loving kindness and this unmerited favor, That's not what this word is. Please, please hear me. Because here when he says grace has been given to us for a little while. See, because grace, in the sense we understand it, is chesed, or loving kindness. It is the Hebrew equivalent to the word charis in Greek, which is the word that is often translated grace in the New Covenant. It's the Greek word charis, and it is that word that is translated undeserved favor. And so when we hear the word grace, we automatically think that, but that's not what this word is. The word that is generally translated grace in Hebrew is chesed, but this word grace is a Hebrew word, and it's the Hebrew word tekumah. And this grace is a graciousness positively. In other words, something has happened to cause this door to open. And if the thing that happens changes, the door could close. See, the grace of God is eternal. It has been forever said. The charis of God, the undeserved favor of God, that is eternal. But that's not what he's talking about here. He says grace has been given to us for a little while. In other words, something has happened to cause this moment of favor. A supplication or an entreaty has occurred and has been favorably responded to by someone which has altered the previous state of affairs. In other words, something happened to shift the environment. In Ezra's case, it was Cyrus coming to the kingdom. In Ezra's case, it was a politician coming into place that people wouldn't think that God would use, but God used him for his people's sake. And so when Ezra here says, now for a little while, grace has been shown from the Lord our God. Why? Grace, something has opened, and we better seize the moment. Look at your names, and now it's time to do everything that's in your heart. Tell them everything that God has told you to do, now is the time to get about doing it. Everything that's in your spirit, now is the time to go about doing it and watch God fund you from heaven if he has to. Grab your neighbor's hand and tell him you're going to step into things that it looks like there's no way to do. You're going to step into things that you won't have money to finance. But God is going to cause people to come and fund and finance your dream and your vision. Because for a moment, for a little while, a door has been opened for you and I to rebuild the house, to rebuild the wall, to stand in our place. Slap your neighbor high five and tell anybody who fights you in this season is in for a big surprise. Leader, is there anybody who tries to resist you in this season? God will pull them back. I wish I had. Lead your neighbors to anybody who tries to stop the church in this season that may be your last day of life. I'm telling you, God is going to move his agenda forward. My God in heaven, I feel like preaching that. Leave your neighbors and God will move them if you just start moving. Tell them he'll get them out of the way. Now I'm prophesying to you, there are going to be some people that oppose God's agenda that will drop dead in the street. Leave your neighbors and get up and get to it. No, I said, look at your neighbors and get up and get to it. Tell them God is going to fund you. He's going to finance you. He's going to open doors for you. He's going to make people who don't like you finance you. He's going to turn. Hallelujah. I don't know who I'm preaching to. Grab your neighbors. those hands and then just start moving toward it. God is going to see your help as you're walking. He's not going to show it to you in the house. He's going to show it to you as you're walking toward it. Because this is about your destiny. This is about your time. This is about the season, my God, you just got into. And I'm urging you, don't resist the hand of the Lord. Don't start talking about what's happened. Don't side with the normal people you've been siding with, because they don't have a proper understanding of what has happened. Did you hear what I said? And it was very interesting to me, and please hear me, because I can only speak what I hear God say. God didn't tell me that Mr. Trump was his choice. He told me he was his instrument. And so I went to the inauguration. I stood there. Many of you know I was called as one of the first group of preachers to go and counsel and speak. And I went because God told me to go. And people were talking about me and tweeting me. And preachers were telling me I was an Uncle Tom and I was this and that. But I was being moved by a prophetic wind. I had to sit and hear what God was doing. I had to discern it for myself. I'm praying for Steve Harvey and some of the other ones because they were talking about me. Roland Martin was talking about me. A preacher on the East Coast, he shall remain nameless. He's talking about me and others of us. God told me. And God told me to speak, and I sat in that place and I spoke the wisdom of God into that man's ears. You don't have to like me. See, I'm not called to be your buddy. I am a prophet of the Most High God, and I will sit alone because of his hand if I must. And let me say it clearly, if he calls me back, I will go, and I will stand there, and I will be seen in a picture, and I'll be seen on TV, because I am fighting for the soul of my nation, and for the generations that are yet to come, that are to serve God in a nation under God. God, it's too much. There's too much to say. I look at this. I gotta read this to you because This in chapter 9 is the last impediment that Ezra had to combat before the revival that God had given grace for a moment to manifest, could be manifested. There was one more thing that had to be dealt with among the people of God. And it was there in Ezra chapter 9. Let me prophesy and say to you, many of the things that I am preaching today have already been done. They've been done in other parts of the kingdom. There's already things that have begun to be structured. There's a prayer undergirded. There's an atmospheric change. Some elements of the stage have been set. But now the stage is set for what's in you and me to come forth. Just like Zerubbabel had to come and do his job before Ezra could come and do his job. There are people that have done a job that you and I were not so much involved in. But now the curtain is rising on what's in you and what's in me. I hope somebody's hearing this. Look at your neighbor and tell them, get ready to see your name in your eyes. I'm not talking about Broadway. I'm talking about God's way. Get ready for Him to lift you up and make you know. Watch it. I got to stop. Look at this. Go to Ezra chapter 9. Go there quickly. I'm about to run out of time. But I'm going to pray for you as God directed me this morning. I'm going to pray for you. And Ezra chapter 9, Ezra deals with the major impediment, the last major impediment of the national restoration. And that was the part of his assignment to deal with. The temple is now built. The gold and silver vessels taken by Nebuchadnezzar have been restored back to Jerusalem. The temple worship and the sacrifices are now being done again. If you read the book of Ezra very carefully, you'll find that the feast days were being observed. They hadn't kept the feast of Passover, the feast of Pentecost, the feast of Sukkot. They had not kept those feasts for almost 60 years. They had not had their appointed times with God. And so one of the first things that started happening was the sacrifice that started going up, and they began to restore the feast days. But something was going on in the house, and Ezra addresses it. In Ezra chapter 9, verse 1, notice it says that when these things were done, the leaders came to me saying, the people of Israel and the priests and the Levites have not separated themselves from the peoples of the land. The temple is built. They're singing again. They're worshiping again. They're even giving again. As a matter of fact, we got more resources than we need in the house. I'm not talking about us right now. We believe in God. But that was the testimony there. So that's going to be our testimony. We're going to see. Watch this. But they came and said, the people have not separated themselves from the people. In other words, they're going to church, but they're still thinking like the people. The people of Israel, the priests, and the Levites have not separated themselves from the peoples of the lands with respect to the abominations of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Egyptians, and the Amorites, for they have taken some of their daughters as wives for themselves and their sons, so that the holy seed is mixed with the peoples of those lands. Now, lest some ignorant racist will attempt to say that this is preaching against intermarriage. That is not the issue. Intermarriage between the ethnicities, that's not what's being talked about here. This is being talked about. What's being talked about here is the spirit of compromise, which although they were worshiping and singing and giving, there was still a compromise. The spirit of compromise was still prevalent amongst the people of God, amongst the church. The issue of intermarriage with pagans was raised. And what is being pointed out here is although the people are attending church, they still have an allegiance to things and to relationships that pull their hearts away from God's word and doing it. See, the reason God taught that his children were not to marry the children of the age or the land is because he knew that if you marry it, it can sway your heart.
That's what Solomon was the embodiment of. He had 700 wives and 300 concubines, and he married women of the nations that they overtook. And so what he began to do when he got married to them, he began to allow them to worship their God while he worshiped his God. And so he actually built temples for his wives so they could go and worship the pagan gods. And what happened is they began to pull his heart away from the worship of his God. Because when you allow people who don't believe that your God is God, when you hook up with them and you allow them to lead you down, you're looking at me crazy. But why should I be tolerant of that which is intolerant of me? Nobody saying anything. Why in the morning? I mean, let me get back up here. So, Israel is speaking this immorality with David, is speaking to the allegiance to those things or relationships that pull our hearts away from God's word and doing. He said, the holy seed is mixed. Now, please understand, in our covenant, the holy seed is not the people, the holy seed is the world. The Bible declares in 1 Peter 1 and 23 that you and I have been born again by the incorruptible seed of the Word of God. So the spirit of compromise is not who you're married to. It's what you allow to pull you away from God's Word and doing it. Because anything that will pull you away from God's Word, you are unholy wed to. You are in a marriage that is unholy. You are in a relationship that is pulling you away from the Word. Look at your neighbor. Ask him, what are you married to? See, in this context, you can be single in the flesh and married in the spirit because you are tied up to stuff that is pulling you away from the Word of God. Oh God, I'm almost done. I'm out of time, but I'm almost done. Can I have 10 minutes? I'm asking you because I won't give up. Can I have 10 minutes? Let me show you what the compromise was. Go back, and this is a whole other message. I may have to preach it separately soon, but go back real quickly to Ezra chapter 4 and verse 1. Let me show you because this spirit had raised its head up early. But it hadn't been dealt with. And the people didn't recognize it. Are you still here? Look at Ezra chapter 4 and verse 1. Can y'all take this? Am I okay? Okay, let me just give me a few more minutes and I'll be done. Look at Ezra chapter 4 and verse 1. It says, now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the descendants of the captivity were building the temple of the Lord, God of Israel, they came to Zerubbabel. And the heads of the fathers' house and said to them, let us build with you. Oh! Watch this. They came to Zerubbabel, and the heads of the fathers, let me read it again, because some of y'all just got there. So let me start it again, because I want you to see this spirit of compromise. I want you to see what it is, and how subtle it is. Now, when the adversaries, everybody say the adversaries. When the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the descendants of the captivity were building the temple of the Lord God of Israel, they came to Zerubbabel, who was the leader of the enterprise, and the heads of the fathers' houses, and said to them, let us build with you. Again, we are your adversary. But let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do. And we have sacrificed to him since the days of Esarhaddon, king of Assyria. So these are Assyrians who brought us here. But Zerubbabel and Yeshua and the rest of the heads of the fathers' house of Israel said to them, you may do nothing with us. You may do nothing with us to build a house for our God, but we alone will build to the Lord of Israel. And as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, has commanded us. Watch this. Then the people of the land tried to discourage the people. Just watch this. First, they wanted to get rid of them. And when they wouldn't let them with them, they tried then to discourage them. Are you still here? They troubled them in building and hired counselors. They started putting lawsuits against them. They started using political influence. So you can't say marriage is this. So you can't call on the name of the Lord in your school. You can't say Jesus in school. Let me apply this. They had counseled against him to frustrate their purpose all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even unto the reign of Darius, king of Syria. Let me explain this so you can really get it and really understand it. Let's go back up to verse 1, and I'll be done. I promise you. It says that when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the descendants of the captivity were building the temple. But now get it. Don't miss this. They were adversaries of Judah and Benjamin. They were not adversaries of the whole church. They were not adversaries of the whole house of God. As a matter of fact, there were some elements of the house of God that were willing to welcome them. You do understand that Judah and Benjamin are only two of the 12 tribes of Israel. There were 12 tribes. But notice, they're only against Judah and Benjamin. They are the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin. They're not the adversaries of Dan. They're not the adversaries of Reuben. They're not the adversaries of the half tribe of Manasseh and Ephraim. They are adversaries of Judah and Benjamin. Judah means praise. Benjamin means the son of my strength. They are the adversaries of the whole church. They are adversaries of the church that intends to be a praise to God in the earth. The church that intends to walk by His word and not compromise. The church that intends to make sure that whatever the word says, that's what we're going to do. And if you say something else is okay, and you legislate that it's okay, we're still going to say it's not okay, because we're going to be a praise to God. They were adversaries of Judah, praise, and Benjamin, strength. Daniel said, and they that know their God will be strong. And you see, they were adversaries of the people who actually knew their God, who knew what their God said, who knew what their God meant. But let me say it out loud. The whole church is not being fought. Judah and Benjamin are being fought. There are churches now that will license homosexuals and will make lesbians bishops. That is not the church that I belong to. That is not the church of Judah. That is not the tribe of Benjamin. You don't like me. I don't care. Now you can do it if you want to. The law says you can do it. I will protect your right to do it. But I will also protect my right to lift up my voice and say, thus saith the word of the Lord. But get it. The adversaries, not adversaries of the whole church, the adversaries of the church that is purposed to be a praise to God. They are adversaries of the church that is purposed to be strong in the nation for God. And they come and say, let us build with you. Let's have a rainbow coalition. Let's say, I don't care, I don't care. Let us. We just let everybody in because we want to be inclusive. And we want to be open to everybody. Let me say it real clearly. Because you and I, as the children of God, are to listen. We're not talking about staying away from sinners. So you and I can have a relationship with sinners. These are so-called Christians that want to compromise the doctrine of the church and want to move the landmark. You're not listening to me. So God didn't mind you relating to sinners because they don't know anything. You and I are called to influence people who have no knowledge of God. But what you got to be careful of is these people who have collars and chains and no convictions. You have Bibles and pinky rings, clean robes and dirty lives. Why are you doing that? Notice what the little bit says. Thank you. Give me a hand. You can build with us. You can't build with us because what you're actually trying to do is change us to agree with you. And we will get married to you. We're not going to marry you for your money. We're not going to marry you for your exposure. We're not going to marry you so we can be on TV. To hell with your money, your exposure, and your TV. We're not going to marry you. Your church payable to you? Y'all still here? Do you get this? They are adversaries, but they want to build it with you. See the strategy of the enemy. They want to associate and assimilate. Ease their conscience and satisfy their spiritual longings because everybody wants to be spiritual. But people want spirituality without love. They want spirituality without effort. They want spirituality without standing. And the thing is that the church must get back to saying God receives everybody. But he also changes everybody he receives. See, the Bible says he receives a son, but then he chastens a son. And he said, and if you reject the chastening, the correction, if you don't allow the same spirit that drew you to correct you, you are a bastard and not a son. That's the Bible. Grab it in his hand and tell him, if you want to hang out with me, you got to be willing to be transformed with me. You got to be willing to let this word change you. You got to be willing to let this word circumcise you. And when you or I have an idea that they line up with the word, we cut our ideas off and we go with the word and we call on the Spirit of God to change us. And we continue to confess we are the righteousness of God until we are saved. That's good preaching.
They want to associate and to assimilate to ease their conscience and satisfy their spiritual longing, but ultimately, they want to desecrate. By getting you and I to compromise the basic and foundational tenets of the faith, we must love, but we must not compromise. Notice they were not adversaries of all God's people.